many newspapers in the travel sections offer you the opportunity of a very interesting European experience. How about skiing in the beautiful Tatra Mountains, followed by warm reception in Hungary, a quick look at northern Italy, up to Dunkirk, and down to La Rochelle, and a boat ride from La Rochelle to Portsmouth, and on to Scotland. Sounds attractive. But it wasn't for Peter Lindsay in 1940, desperately trying to escape from the Nazis. Not your conventional holiday itinerary. That traumatic and hazardous journey, fortunately, had a silver lining, because it ended here, and I do mean here, at City and Guilds College, because Peter's superior officer realized that Peter was quite unusual. He sent him to City and Guilds College, where he gained his bachelor's and his PhD. Okay, if we now fast forward over many decades during which Peter achieved high distinction and international recognition in his chosen field, we arrive at his most generous benefaction of about £1 million, primarily to relieve student hardship, but also to make possible an annual lecture in his memory. Those lectures, 9 so far, have been most informative and enjoyable. Flat panel television was an early theme. Later, we had a fleeting encounter with little green men who were quickly dismissed in favor of pulsars by the person who invented pulsars. Professor Dame Jocelyn Bell Burnell. And last year, we were able to contemplate in the engaging company of the Astronomer Royal the possible existence of parallel universes. Tonight, the subject is biology. Not just biology, but great ideas in biology. And who better to guide us through this topic than one who has won a related Nobel Prize and is now director of the fabulous new Francis Crick Institute. So it's my pleasure to invite Sir Paul Nurse to present the 10th Peter Lindsay Memorial Lecture. Sir Paul.
Thank you, Bob, for that. Thank you. Good. Thank you for that introduction, and nice to be here to give this lecture, number 10 in the series. I'm going to talk about great ideas of biology, because on the whole, biologists don't talk about great ideas very much, or grand theories. This differs them, by the way, from physicists, who are always talking about great ideas. Biologists are more comfortable, really, with details, with particulars. We like to count the numbers of species, maybe in a habitat. If we were in the 19th century, we would have been counting hairs on beetles' legs. Today, we sequence genes, but it's much the same sort of impetus. We determine the content of cells, what RNA and proteins might be there. But biology does have some great ideas, and I will talk about 4 of them this evening, and will point in the direction of a 5th, which is being formulated and I think will be more important as we proceed into the 21st century. And I hope as a consequence of this, you will get a better sense of what life is, which is of course the main interest of biology. It will be a mixture of history, quite a lot of history, and philosophy and some science, and I hope make connections across some of these ideas that you will find interesting. I have up here the Francis Crick Institute that I'm director of, which I've just moved into. It's a great new initiative which includes a major connection between Imperial College and the Crick Institute, which is very, very important for our multidisciplinary agenda. Now, the first great ideas of biology, and the first idea is the cell, the basic unit of life. That's where I'm going to start. It's easily stated. All life is composed of cells, and the cell is the simplest unit exhibiting the characteristics of life. In a sense, it's the cell is life's atom. It's the basic unit of life. Now, this idea started in the 17th century, and it took nearly 200 years to fully develop. And as is often the case in science, and that's why engineering is so important, technology begat discovery. And without that, you would not make many new discoveries. In this case, it was the microscope. And you see the microscope I'm talking about there is on the left. It was Robert Hooke's microscope. And the drawing you see up there is the first picture we have of a cell. The one in black and white is the one that Hooke drew. I put a scanning electron microscopic picture of the same material next to it to show what it looks like. Robert Hooke was the experimentalist, really, for the Royal Society. This is 1665, only 5 years over since the establishment of the Society. He looked down the microscope at living things. He saw these boxes. It reminded him of monks' cells in a monastery, and that's where the name cell actually comes from. Hooke was actually employed as an experimentalist for the Society because the Society was made up of gentlemen. And of course, gentlemen don't actually do anything with their hands, as we all know. So they hired somebody else to do the work with their hands, and they watched him and listened to him. But he was a great experimentalist. And once Hooke had seen cells, as is so often the case again in science, everybody else saw cells. Once it had been established, there was something interesting here. And from the 1660s through to the 1690s, there were many observations, particularly of plant cells. And I'm going to show you an image here, the one on the left, of Nehemiah Grew. It's from a book I have from 1682, which shows the cross-section of a vine, and it's a beautiful image, looking at that, which you could have discovered in a mid-20th century plant textbook. And on the right, once again, a scanning image of the same subject. This was followed by work from Malpighi and Leeuwenhoek, and Leeuwenhoek discovered single-celled life, microbes. And what he did is, he took a little stick and scraped between his teeth and put it on underneath a microscope. And he saw these objects, which he's drawn here. I particularly like a figure B, where obviously the bacterium, which is what it is, did a sort of loop-the-loop underneath the microscope whilst he was looking at it. Leeuwenhoek was a draper. He lived in Delft. He sent all his observations to the Royal Society, actually. We have over 1,000 of his letters, which are actually there. And he called these single-cell animalcules, which we now would call bacteria. One interesting thing about him was that he was the executor of Vermeer's will. They both lived and were neighbours in Delft. Vermeer died in his 40s and left a number of children. And what is unusual about Vermeer for the time is he did two paintings of a scientist, a geographer and an astronomer. And this is one of them. And I like to imagine that this may be Leeuwenhoek. There is not one shred of evidence in favor of this hypothesis, but it is a nice story. And there is an engraving of Leeuwenhoek, and he wears a similar coat. So let's leave it there, okay? Now, over 100 years passed through the 18th century with better microscopy, with better histology. Cells were discovered everywhere, in plants, in animals, in blood, it was clearly identified as a common feature of life. And that led, in 1839, to the birth of the cell doctrine. And this followed on fairly rapidly after Dalton had described atoms as the basic unit of matter. And in this case, Schleiden and Schwann, this is rather serious German professor, Theodor Schwann, described cells as the basic structural unit of life. What he, if it's a quote here, from translated from the German, we have seen that all organisms are composed of essentially like parts, namely of cells. So it's the basic unit of life. A little later, another famous German scientist, Rudolf Virchow, who was, by the way, the founder of pathology, took that idea and pushed it a little further, and pushed it to establishing that the cell was also the simplest and basic functional unit of life, not simply structural unit of life. As you see up there, every animal appears as a sum of vital units, living units, each of which bears within itself the complete characteristics of life. So the cell was the seat of life, the simplest unit of life. This is actually a major milestone in science. It's not always recognized as such, but it's a major milestone in science that was articulated here in the middle of the 19th century. Because the cell underpins all reproduction and development in every living thing, including ourselves. Here's a modern picture of a cell. This is a mouse embryo here, and if you look carefully, you'll see these little black dots here. Each one of these is a single cell, and that embryo was formed from an egg undergoing repeated divisions to produce that organism. And if I failed to convince you that cells are interesting, I will show you one other picture, which is this one, and remind every one of you in this room that you once looked like this, because all of you once were a single cell. If you don't have interest anymore, there are two doors at the back. They are really, really important. The cell is, as I've said, the basic unit of life. It underpins all reproduction and development. It is constantly in the news in various guises. At the moment, the guise is stem cells, which tells us something about how animals develop, how cancers form, and how the cells may be manipulated to make new tissues and possibly new organs for treatment of degenerative diseases. So a very, very important concept. So that's my first great idea. It's the cell. My second, the gene. The gene as the basis of heredity. Now, from ancient times, it was observed that particular characteristics are passed down from generation to generation, from parents to their offspring. And it was thought a lot about what the basis of this heredity might be. Even philosophers like Aristotle, for example, speculated on what the cause of this might be. And it was a problem that was being tackled again in the 19th century by plant breeders across Europe who were crossing plants with different characteristics to try and understand what heredity was going on there, but also to try and improve the plants for various purposes, such as for food crops. But it was complicated. They would take different plants, they would cross them to each other, they'd have certain characteristics. Sometimes those characteristics disappeared, and then sometimes they re-emerged later with later generations. And there was lots of description and very little understanding. Actually, there's quite a lot of science, which is a lot of description and not so much understanding, but that's a different lecture that I'm not doing tonight. The problem was cracked by the gardening monk Gregor Mendel, shown here. Gregor Mendel was a monk in a monastery in Brno, which I've been to quite a few times in the Czech Republic. And he belonged to an order, and there's no other way to describe it really, he belonged to an order of scientific monks. It's not something that one thinks about so much in the 21st century, but in the 19th century, there were certain monastic foundations which had a great deal of interest in particular areas, including science. And the one in Brno had a particular interest in science. And he went as a poor boy to be trained as a monk. He was sent to school. He wanted to do physics. He went to the University of Vienna. He failed his examinations. He never got a degree. He was sent back to the monastery and was allowed to teach low-level physicists in the local schools. And he was interested in all sorts of things, actually. He was interested in astronomy. I've seen his telescope. He made a map of the moon. Interested in meteorology, traced the fall of atmospheric pressure during storms and so on. So he was one of these driven by curiosity and interested in many things. But he was particularly interested in plants, and he was interested in sorting out what happened during heredity and what was happening when different plants with different characters were crossed and how you could investigate it. Now, I think because he was trained as a physicist, he took a rather more of a physicist's approach to the problem than, say, a biologist of the time, who tended to be rather more descriptive. He decided that, first of all, you had to identify the appropriate material that you could actually study. And he did a collection of trial crosses with about six different species, crossed them and did some trial experiments to see whether any of the crosses could make any sense to him. And what he did was essentially cheated. He threw away five of the species because he could make no sense of them. And he took the sixth, which he could make sense of. I say cheated, of course, it's not at all cheating. In science, you have to choose material and approaches that work. It's absolutely no good having great ideas and getting lost in the inadequacies of the material that you're actually investigating. And he chose the pea, and he chose the pea because it had very clear characteristics which he could cross. And the monastery gave him very good research facilities. This is a photograph I took at the height of the Cold War in 1981, when I first visited the monastery. And this was his garden, which is actually very significant in size. But not only that, next to it, but now no longer there, was a greenhouse of exactly the same size. I mean, as good as, I'm sure, the facilities in Imperial College. And he used these facilities to carry out many crosses with peas. And the peas, as I said, have very clear variants, which define, for example, the shape and color of the seed, the stem length, the color of flowers, and so on. And what he did, which also followed from his physicist's training, was he accurately, not only accurately recorded what he saw, but he counted what he saw. He counted what he saw. And rather than just describing, he was quantitative in his approach. And finally, also deriving, I think, from his physical training, having made his observations, he generated a theory or law that would explain them, and then went on to test it. Again, an approach that the descriptive natural historians would not have naturally taken place. So what did he do? What did he find out? Well, he observed that in the first generation, that is, if you take two plants and you cross them and say they have a tall and they're short or they're white and they're purple, it doesn't matter what it is. What he found was that when he crossed them, often one of those characteristics disappeared in the offspring of the first generation, just disappeared. But if you then took those offspring and crossed them with themselves, it would reappear in the next generation. And not only would it reappear, but because he counted what was going on, it reappeared in very clear ratios. In this particular and simple instance, as I'm sure many of you learnt at school, it came out in a distinct ratio of 3 to 1, with the character that was disappearing being the 1 versus 3, which were dominating. Now, he didn't leave it there. He developed a theory. And that was important because I'm going to tell you something I discovered only a few years ago, that Charles Darwin, more of him later, also did crosses at around the same time with snapdragons, also recorded a 3 to 1 ratio, and left it there. He didn't come up with any hypothesis as to how he took it forward. And that was published, again, in one of the books I have in 1868. Now, why was that 3 to 1 ratio important? It was because it led him to propose what is essentially a particulate theory of heredity. That is, that there are particles involved which are unchanging, and if there's particles, then you can get certain ratios out because you're segregating particles. And what he postulated, and I'm going to use modern language for it, it's not if you read the original paper what he said, he proposed that there were particles that influenced characters, or determined characters, these we would now call genes, that in each parent, in each plant, there were 2 such particles, but only 1 was passed on in the gametes that that plant would form. But on fertilization, the duplex nature was reformed with 1 particle from 1 parent, 1 particle from the other parent, and that when these particles appeared in the same plant, one might dominate over the other, so you only determined the characteristic of the dominant one, but the one that we would now call recessive would re-emerge because in the next generation, 1/4 of the plants would actually pair up again with one of the recessive particles. Now, this was an absolutely brilliant piece of abstract reasoning outside the normal remit of biology. Completely right and completely ignored. Nobody took any notice of it. It wasn't that the observations were ignored. If you look, for example, I think it's in the 9th edition of the Encyclopedia Britannica, published in the 1880s, they talk about Mendel's experiments, but they take no notice of Mendel's theory to explain it. Then it was rediscovered about 35 years later, at the beginning of the 20th century, by 3 groups almost simultaneously. The first group, who repeated it, tried to ignore Mendel altogether and published it without reference to Mendel. The second group, having been scooped by the first one, dug around, found Mendel, and referred to him repeatedly so they could undermine the other one who hadn't referred to his work at all. And then the third one did all the experiments properly and had enough numbers to make it actually all work. That is only a slight caricature. There's quite a lot of truth, but there is a bit of caricature in there. What had happened then to lead to this now being accepted? And there were several things. One is chromosomes have been discovered. Here we're back to cells, and here we see an onion squash from the late 19th century, and chromosomes have been found by researchers looking at plant material. And if you looked at a cell here and you saw these strings, which we now know, of course, are made of genes, segregating in a dividing cell, it would make you think that this was hereditary material. And then, most importantly, Van Beneden was looking at nematodes. Nematodes are little worms, chromosomes. And once again, this shows how important the biological material is that you choose. This organism only has 4 chromosomes. So it's easy to count. And when it makes its gametes, you see only 2 chromosomes. And when those gametes fuse, you end up with 4 chromosomes. And this is, of course, exactly what Mendel's abstract reasoning predicted, but this was a concrete confirmation of objects that were behaving in the same way. And although it's not clear if that's the case, I'm sure this influenced the acceptability of this particular, particular hypothesis. This idea really developed through the 20th century. DNA was discovered as the biological material in this organism, pneumococcus. It was discovered by three researchers, Avery, McLeod, and McCarty, in 1944, working in Rockefeller Institute in New York, now Rockefeller University, of which I used to be president for 8 years, some years ago. And they showed that if they had two different strains of pneumococcus, which differed, one was smooth, one was rough, if they extracted DNA from one and sprinkled it onto the other, it could convert the pneumococcus from one form to another. So they postulated that deoxyribonucleic acid was the material that was responsible for heredity. And then, of course, by the way, when I became president, I should say, in 2003, there was a cocktail party to welcome me, and this little old man came up to me and shook my hand and introduced himself as Mac McCarty. And I looked at him and I said, "You're not the Mac McCarty, are you?" And he said, "Yes, I am the Mac McCarty." He was 92. He'd done this work in 1944. He died several years later, but it was quite extraordinary to have this link back to this major discovery. Now, of course, we tend to think of DNA with Watson, Crick, and Wilkins, and Franklin, for example. What they did, of course, was determine the structure of DNA. They accepted the Avery conclusions that DNA was the hereditary material. They determined the structure, the iconic double helix, a story well known to you. Francis Crick was the real brains behind all of this. Watson had lots of intuition, but also lots of wildness as well. And Crick also invented here what we now know as the central dogma, which was used in various ways, but where I just took an illustration from the very early on, where DNA is transcribed into RNA, RNA is translated into protein, and those proteins determine many of the characteristics of cells and therefore organisms. So you had the beginning of a mechanistic, a molecular explanation of how genes through DNA can determine characteristics of an organism. I'll say a little more about that a little later. So the gene, my second idea, it's the basis of heredity. It can explain how you go from genotype to phenotype, where phenotype is the characteristics of an organism that make them up. And it has many, many implications. One obvious one is it has implications for what we are. How determined are we by our genes, by our environment? How should that affect how society thinks about people, how it thinks about crime, how it thinks about education? Very, very important issues, often contentious, and they have their origins in this notion of the gene as the basis of heredity. Third idea, evolution by natural selection. This is a very powerful and very beautiful idea. It's central to all biology. If you went to Waterstones or any bookshop of that sort and went to the popular science section, you could be forgiven to thinking that there's only two areas in science, actually. One of them is evolution by natural selection and the other is string theory. And of course, that isn't true, but there are endless books about evolution and natural selection. The idea actually has two parts, and it's important to be clear of that. The first part is that life evolves, that is, it changes over time, and there is a tree of life where all organisms are related by descent. And that's one idea, which is actually quite an old idea, has a little bit of its origins with Aristotle once again, the second idea is more closely associated with Charles Darwin, which I'll show you in a moment, which is that the major mechanism for evolutionary change, not the only mechanism, but the major mechanism is natural selection. Now, both of these ideas, as I said, are associated with Charles Darwin, the gentleman there on the right. But I just want to give you a bit of introduction with his grandfather on the left, who is Erasmus Darwin. Because Erasmus Darwin, who lived in the 18th century, was also a great proponent of evolution. It was also proposed by others like Lamarck and Buffon, for example. But Erasmus was a doctor. He lived in Lichfield in Derby, and he was a member of the Lunar Society. That is the society of scientists, industrialists, entrepreneurs, and fundamentally just interesting intellectuals, used to meet once a month in the Midlands, not linked with any university or seat of learning. They were nicknamed the Lunatics because they met once a month under the full moon, where they would ride home after, I'm sure, sometimes drinking too much. He was an extraordinary character, was Erasmus. He was a fat, charming man with a terrible stutter, but a wonderful conversationalist. He cut out a oval from his dining room table so he could sit closer to his food. He was famous as a doctor, not because he could cure anybody, because bluntly, no doctors could cure anybody in the 18th century, but in fact, that had to wait till the 20th century before much happened there. But in the 18th century, he was very good at telling you whether you would die or not. And that was extremely useful because it means you could then settle your affairs and so on, and maybe come to those conclusions about who was going to inherit your wealth at the last point in your life, which might be quite good. He charged his patients according to their income. And so he raised all his money from his rich patients. But because of his interest in evolution, and he had on his coach everything from shells, because in a shell there's a formless mollusk, and he said everything evolved from that. He lived in the Cathedral Close in Lichfield, and the dean did not like this very much, and so started putting his rich patients off, so he had to paint out his motto. George III asked him to be his doctor. He turned him down. He was a Republican, I think, turned him down several times. He was a scientist, a doctor, and a poet. He wrote most of his scientific observations up in poetry. And I have several of these books from this time, a complete crazy guy. So it was really, really interesting. Incidentally, he also wrote a book on, and was a proponent on education for girls, and established the first public school for female education in Britain. Extraordinary person. He argued that life evolved, but it was his grandson, Charles, there, who gathered the vast amounts of data that supported this idea based on the fossil record and on his observations of living animals and plants. He went on this famous beagle trip for 5 years and then made many, many observations, and then retreated to of animals and plants and geology. And then he retreated to Down in Kent, and eventually writing The Origin of Species in 1859, where he had one illustration in that, which was this here, which is a tree of life, showing everything is related. So we have all the letters at the bottom, and then you end up with the living species at the top, and this is how you get there. Note that he wasn't quite sure whether life appeared once or more than once. Actually, we're not entirely sure even now. But that's the only illustration in this book. What he did was he observed that living organisms were adapted exquisitely, in some cases, to their lifestyles and their environments. And I've sort of caricatured this here, where you see his famous Darwin's finches on the Galapagos Islands, it's a volcanic island, and the birds went there and diversified into all these different types. You can see, just focus on the beaks, which do different things. They crack nuts, or they look for insects under bark, or whatever. And I've put in here these sort of pincers, which all have specialist functions too, which we have, of course, designed intelligently, whilst this evolved by natural selection over there. Now, he'd produced this idea in the 1840s. It took him a long time to publish it, and many think that he was rather nervous to do it, but was stimulated to publish it because he received a letter from Alfred Wallace in 1858. Alfred Wallace was a collector. He was in Borneo, suffering from malaria, and in high fever, had exactly the same idea. and wrote a 20-page letter to Darwin explaining it. And poor old Charles was suddenly faced with 20 years of his thinking being discovered by somebody else. He was a decent fellow, and so he felt that he shouldn't stand in the way of the publication of Wallace. But his friends, including Hooker, who was running Kew at the time, said that you should present this together, or the two papers together, and it was done at the Linnaean Society, which is Burlington House. If you go there, you'll find the Darwin and Wallace room, but neither of them were there. Darwin stayed in Down, and Wallace was still having fever in Borneo. It was in 1858, and nobody took any notice of these two papers either. But in 1859, he published his great book. But I should say one thing. Actually, Charles Darwin was not the first person to suggest natural selection. There were at least two reports, and one was very clear. In 1831, a Patrick Matthew, a tree grower, wrote a book on naval timber and had a 2 to 3 page potted summary of evolution by natural selection. Darwin didn't know about it, but in his later editions, he acknowledges this piece of work. So what is this great idea? Well, the idea is that the natural selection of natural selection is that within a species, there are variants, and these are due to inheritable differences. We now know, of course, it's genes responsible for that. Those variants which are most successful will reproduce more, and therefore they will pass on more of their genes to the next generation. They will occupy more of the population. So this was so-called survival of the fittest. It wasn't Darwin's term. It was the social scientist Spencer who invented that. And gradually, these changes in gene composition led to changes in characteristics of the species, eventually leading to the species being unable to breed with the original form, and that led to evolution. So that's the idea. It is actually a beautiful idea and very simple, and it gets rid of the sense of purpose because it comes about by this random chance, which is why, of course, it's so contentious today. I just want to repeat that argument that I just made, however, and link it to the two earlier ideas I spoke to you about, the cell and the gene. It's an idea, a way of looking at it, presented by Muller in the middle of the last century. And Muller defined life as saying, living things have properties which allow them to undergo natural selection and therefore to evolve. In other words, he used that as the definition of life. And his properties he identified were, life must reproduce, clear. Life has a hereditary system whereby information defines the characteristics of an organism, and that's inherited during reproduction. We've already discussed that. And thirdly, the hereditary system exhibits some variability upon which, therefore, selection can work. And if we now look at the reproduction of the cell, where the characteristics of the cell is determined by the genes within the cell, the two first ideas I spoke about, this is selection at the level of the single cell. So what we have here is a sort of orange cell, which divides. It has a mutation, an alteration in its DNA, so that one side makes a red cell. Let's now say that red cells are more successful, then ultimately red cells will replace the orange cells. Now, why I put it like that is that these three ideas of the cell, the gene, and the way genes work, and evolution by natural selection are all linked. They are part of a triad of ideas that are central for biology. Now, Charles Darwin, of course, is iconic. This is the sort of photograph that we mostly know of him with his great beard. He finishes The Origin of Species with this great sentence. While this planet has gone cycling on according to the fixed law of gravity, from so simple a beginning, endless forms, most beautiful and most wonderful, have been and are being evolved. Why can't I write scientific papers like that? Right? Why can't I do it? I don't know. Even when I try, it gets edited out by these damn reviewers that I have to go through. But I want you to pay attention to one thing there. He was referring, of course, to Isaac Newton. Isaac Newton was the god of science. He was saying biology can have laws of great profundity, just like physics, and that's very important. Well, this is still a very current idea. All life evolves and is related by descent. natural selection major mechanism. Ideas within this, kin selection, are relevant to thinking about altruism and morality. And this last point is one that I heard in a lecture when I was an undergraduate, is if we recognize that we are all related to all other living things in some sense on the planet, do we not have a responsibility to be stewards for all our relatives out there if we are, should it be true, the highest form of life that's on this planet? A nice idea, a sort of basis for thinking why we have to think about the biosphere and preserving it. Next idea, life as chemistry. Chemistry and physics are the mechanistic basis of life. Now, this is also an important idea. Evolution by natural selection is a sort of historical idea. It talks about life in a rather abstract way. This is talking about how you understand how life works. It's the sort of thing I do in the lab. It's a sort of understanding the nature of living of things. Now, it used to be argued, again from Aristotle, third time I've mentioned him in this talk, living things had a natural end or goal, and they were driven by an inner vital force, which was called vitalism, and it was different from the laws of physics and chemistry. So there was something special that separated life away from non-life. And the replacement of that idea with the idea here that we should think in terms of physics and chemistry for understanding life, which is really critical and I want to consider today. Now, central to developing this idea was this scientist here. This is Lavoisier. This is actually, for me, the greatest painting of a scientist in that I know of. It's in the Metropolitan Museum in New York. It used to be in the office I had in Rockefeller University, and we had to sell it because I didn't do it, but my predecessors, for $100 million, though, which had one of the various financial crises that academic institutions go through. But it's a great picture. This is his wife, actually, over here, who was also his research assistant. They worked together. Now, Lavoisier was the founder of modern chemistry. That's why he's best known. But he was investigated, being French. He was very interested in fermentation and the making of wine. And he was investigating how the sugar of the grape was turned into alcohol. He measured the sugar levels, showed that it was mostly turned into ethanol, and that small amounts of yeast were present in that mix. And he began to think that chemistry was important in life. Unfortunately, he couldn't take the theory very far because, in addition, he was a tax collector. And this was just before the French Revolution. So this is another picture of Lavoisier, and you'll see over there the guillotine, because he lost his head in 1794, and his judge argued that the Republic has no need of chemists and savants. We always have to be careful to trust politicians, you know. Give them a bit of power and they chop your head off. So there was the scientist. He actually supported the revolution, but he, you know how it went all crazy in the latter parts. Anyway, his mantle was picked up by another great French scientist, Louis Pasteur, and he also was looking at fermentation, and he demonstrated in the 1850s that living microbes were responsible for the chemical transformations that you see in fermentation. How did he discover that? And I tell you what's interesting about it, he wasn't doing any what we mistakenly called basic research or whatever. He was doing applied research. He was given a problem by the sugar beet fermenters in Lille, because sometimes their fermentations went wrong and they didn't make sugar. They made acetic acid, which was no good for anything. He turned his microscope onto the fermentations and found when they made acetic acid, there were bacteria there. When they made alcohol, there was yeast there. So he simply said to the industrialist there, put some yeast in these fermentations and it will all work. And it did, and he had, therefore, utterly reliable fermentation. But he took that, of course, a step further and argued that fermentation, and I'm quoting, was a physiological act yielding chemical products necessary for the cell, and such chemical reactions are an expression of the life of the cell. In other words, You understand the cell in terms of its chemistry. And this led to the subject of biochemistry and our and then to molecular biology, which occurred during the subsequent century, where it was argued that life's processes could mostly be reduced to chemistry, that physics also played a role. And central to that is the proteins that make up all our cells. These are, this is a protein here, and those little balls are different amino acids, and the sequence of amino acids which determine the structure of these proteins is determined by the sequence of the genes, which is why it's encoded by the DNA that make up genes. And these proteins act like little factories in our cells. They catalyze many, many hundreds of different chemical reactions that are occurring in our cell, each of our cells, and that those reactions are determined by the microenvironment that is created by that enzyme, where there can be positive and negative charges, there can be portions of the protein which don't like water and others which do like water, and this all generates a structure and a chemical environment that allows amazing chemical reactions to take place. I just tried to schematize that. The bottom there is an enzyme. It takes a substrate, which is a triangle, and then through a series of changes, changes the shape and characteristics till it makes a different sort of thing altogether, all determined by the shape and makeup. And in each one of our cells, and this is a metabolic map where each of those dots there is a metabolic reaction, this is just central metabolism, there are thousands of chemical reactions going on simultaneously in each of our cells. And this is occurring at 37 degrees centigrade under mild conditions, reactions that for us to simulate by traditional chemical means might require heating to 500 degrees centigrade. They are all occurring under gentle conditions in a simple environment. And that's how you should look at a cell. A cell which has got lots of structure, and that's normally just discuss the structure, is actually, in my view, a whole collection of chemical microenvironments that are undergoing different chemical reactions that are connected one with another so that you can get the properties that we call life, and this is fundamentally important. So life is chemistry. It provides mechanistic explanations of life in the way I've just explained. It's still very important. It's understanding this is often the basis for understanding many diseases because of aberrations and alterations in these processes, and therefore it's central to modern medicine and the pharmaceutical industry, another key and crucial idea. These then are my four ideas. Most biologists, I think, would agree to these four. They may have others as well, and I want to finish my talk. And if you think I'm talking a little too long, just take a very deep breath, because I'm soon finished. I'm on my last idea, okay? Do you need 10 seconds to take a deep breath and not hear my voice? You can have that. And I'm going to talk about this fifth idea, which is understanding life in terms of information and systems. And this is more speculative, but I think it will be increasingly important, and I think it's using information and systems to give explanations in biology. Now, thinking about biology as a complex system is actually very old. I've traced it back to as far back as I could go with about 20 pages in Immanuel Kant, would you believe, the philosopher, who talked about complex biological systems and how that was important for life. And he was focused on the complexity and the way in which this is organized in a system that you find in life. What was added to that, particularly in the second half of the last century, was the notion of information and that these complex systems could be understood in part by the flow of information through those particular systems. And these systems operate at different levels. I'm going to focus on the chemistry in cells, but neuron systems in brains would be another example. Ecological processes in ecosystems would be a third. And the kernel of the idea is that you can understand and explain higher order biological phenomena. Phenomena like homeostasis, communication, reproduction, spatial and temporal organization of living things in terms of information and information flow through complex systems. So that's the starting point for this approach. And what it does is it emphasizes concepts like regulation, networks, organization, emergent behaviors, and I summarize it all in the following sentence. The objective in taking this approach is to translate the descriptions of the chemical and physical processes carried out in cells into the underlying system and the management of information within that system, i.e. gathering information, storing information, processing information, and using all of that to determine the outputs. And that's really the principle that we're talking about. Now, I think this is best to talk about with just a simple example. And the simple example is, once again, DNA. Now, when we look at DNA, this double helix, mostly we just wax lyrical about the beautiful structure, okay? That isn't really where the beauty of DNA lies. The beauty of DNA is that it is a consequence of this structure that you can understand heredity. Because understanding that structure tells you that what DNA really is a digital information storage device. And that digital information is stored in the order of the four different nucleotides that make up DNA and the sequence in which they are actually found. So the sequence of the nucleotides encodes information. It's digitally encoded. And as a consequence of the central dogma, which I referred to earlier, it will determine protein structure, which in turn will determine the characteristics of proteins, which determine the phenotype, the way that cells behave. But, and this is the important point, it's only when the chemical structure is expressed in terms of information and information storage that it makes biological sense. You can describe the structure in terms of angstroms and where things are placed. It makes no sense at all till it's translated into information. And that's what Watson and Crick did in their theoretical side of that paper. So we understand DNA and what it's done by thinking about information, in this case, how information is stored. And it's fundamental and critical to understanding biology. The second one is illustrated by this here. Now, I don't know if you're like me. I sort of understand most machines built before 1900. And then after 1900, it gets more and more vague, okay? So this is a picture of a steam engine I found in a boat built in 1892 in New Zealand. And what this is a governor, okay? And you can immediately understand it. This is an example of negative feedback. This is a spindle connected to the steam engine. It rotates. When it rotates, these balls are flown out. You can all understand that, yeah? And as a consequence, it lifts its collar, which turns off the valve that controls how much steam goes into the engine. Therefore, the steam is no longer going into the engine. Therefore, the engine slows down until the balls go back in again and the reverse happens. This is a homeostatic mechanism, a negative feedback control. But you only understand what it does when it's described in terms of a negative feedback control. Now, Jacques Aubin-Monod, great French molecular biologist of the 50s and 60s, proposed from their studies in bacteria of lactose metabolism that there was a negative feedback loop operating. And these are three metabolites, three chemicals, being catalyzed going A to B to C. This is the principle by different enzymes. And the concept is that as C builds up, it inhibits A to B, and therefore you shut it down. So therefore, if C is rising, then it'll be switched off, it'll go down again, and you'll have an oscillation around a mean. It's a negative feedback control. If, on the other hand, C acts in a positive feedback way, it becomes a switch. Because as soon as you start going from A to B to C, and then C accelerates A to B, you're on a one-way ticket. You can only keep going, and you become a switch. So you have an example of positive and negative feedback, which is critical to how metabolism is all regulated. Now, I went to a conference which had one wit. I stole this slide from them. This is a radio and all these components are, these are all oncogenes, the names of oncogenes that we have here. And the notion was, that the speaker said, it's all like a circuit. All these genes are connected, and you get out of the radio sound, you get out of the cell, either a normally growing cell, or in this particular case, when there's all these alteration, you might get cancer. So that's the sort of the metaphor, the analogy there. And these various circuits, and I've just shown you a couple of simple ones, can be combined together to give you a whole rich variety of feedback controls, switches, timers, oscillators, toggles, all together that work in complex networks. Now, this is, however, a hardware circuit. And it's very important to realize in biology, it's what's been called rather wonderfully by Dennis Bray, a wetware circuit, because you connect all the different parts of the biological system through water, through solutions and diffusible chemicals, which means that when you want to modify behavior, you not only modify the information that goes in through DNA and so on, but you can reprogram what is connected to what. So it's a much richer environment to imagine how things may actually be connected. So what this is arguing is that we should consider the cell as a complex chemical system, this wetware, and it acts really like a logical computational machine of linked logical modules. And that's the point that I'm trying to make here. Now I'm going to finish with just a few examples of where this sort of thinking might lead. And the first thing is that there are many analogies you can make to other complex systems, from the social sciences downwards. Here is a network of aeroplane routes in the United States, and this is a collection showing you have hubs which connect important places and which allow subsidiary places to actually be connected via the main hub. So the hub is the center. So what you conclude looking at this is, forget what this is, but let's say it's Dulles, is that if you take out Dulles, you're in big trouble. Difficult to imagine, but actually true. However, if you take out, somewhere in the middle, say Kansas City, nobody cares, okay? It simply isn't important. And the reason I put it up there is that the network theorists who work on such complex patterns here have great deal to contribute to understanding networks in biology as well. Second thing to recognize is that biological systems are complicated. And the problem we've got here is that the human brain likes to think in a simple way. So I've put two pathways up here. This is a collection of information going from the left to the right. It's a linear pathway. Our thinking naturally falls in that direction for most of us, or at least as I shall show you, for half of us. And you do something here, and something very closely related is here. However, biology, produced by evolution by natural selection, it's not designed, it's all sort of added on, you get great complexity. So whereas here you know if you block this, you will block this. If I say we'll block this, do you know what the outcome is here? You don't. It's all part of a complex system. And this is life, and this is only a aspect of life which is used rarely. The problem is many of us think like this, and I found the next picture in, I'm a pilot actually, a recreational pilot, and I found this in a manual I read, okay? And this, this says that men think in sort of ons and off switches, okay? And women are much better at thinking of the complexity of things and putting them together. Really true in my lab. That's why I have 50-50 men, women all the time in my lab. Both of them have their virtues. But just thinking like this is bad news. You really do have to have that across the board. When I show that in the United States, people grumble I'm being sexist and so on. But I think we're much more sophisticated in Imperial College. Okay. Now, although I'm talking about a single pathway here, like this, that if you introduce dynamics into information transfer, the whole communication scenario becomes much richer because you can pulse information down such a pathway. And so instead of it just being an on-off switch, if now, for example, you are pulsing two pieces of information down every minute versus four, that can be interpreted differently. Now, that's obvious and doesn't seem very important, but using a metaphor, I'll show you how important it is. If you just have this system here, on, off, then what you can do is you have a traffic light, you know, red or green. If you now introduce dynamics, as the Morse code is, you can write the works of Shakespeare. It's an enormous difference in information transfer if you take note of dynamics. And there is no doubt in my mind that dynamics is going to be important in these pathways that we look at in biology, and we haven't scratched the surface of it yet. There is enormous complexity there, enormous information transfer, which when we do synthetic biology, where we try and build from bottom up on simple engineering principles, which is how it's normally done, we will miss this. If we go the reverse way and take complex systems and strip it down, that complexity will emerge. It's just a particular lesson I think we have to learn. Now, we have to understand how spatial and temporal organization is formed. This is a phage, it's a virus, and we understand how form is produced here because it's just molecules like Meccano sort of linking together, or Lego, better metaphor. But actually, living organisms are organized over a whole wide range of spaces. So, I mean, we recognize in here in this room, little people like me, big people, fat people, thin people, and we are all formed in the same way. And we have to think about that differently, and I put up here Turing's great paper from the 1940s, nothing to do with computing here, but it was a paper he wrote on control circuits over space, which modeled a chemical reaction, the Zabotinsky reaction, which essentially produces spatial structure by diffusion way beyond direct molecular interaction. And there is a principle there that's excited development biology for decades, and it's really not quite got there yet, even now, but which is very important. So that's another factor. And then my last one, before I end with a slightly technicolor ending, not literally, but just in what I'm about to say, is Harrison's clocks here. Because we have to remember, when thinking about information and complexity, we have to remember that biological machines are not designed. They evolve by natural selection. And that means that you start with something and you add things on and you make things more complicated than they need be to actually deliver the outcome. We often think that biological systems, when you work on them, are perfect. They've been designed by evolution, by natural selection, to work perfectly. But we actually have to recognize that it makes do, and it works because it's as good as any other living thing that's around, but that doesn't mean it's perfect. And I use Harrison's clocks here. You remember Harrison the clockmaker, who solved the longitude problem, to illustrate what I mean. There was the longitude prize given by the Admiralty in the 18th century, and you had to have an accurate clock. Harrison made this one. That was Harrison 1. It worked pretty well, but not that well, and he learned from that and completely redesigned it and produced Harrison 2, and then learned from that and made Harrison 3, and then finally what won the prize was Harrison 4. Now, each one of these steps was intelligently designed, so what you see here doesn't look anything like what was up here, in fact, but evolution by natural selection, by the time you got to Harrison's 4, clocks, you'd have many components that were up there that were still there. Our appendix is the obvious example that what we use. So we shouldn't try and be too clever. We shouldn't try and think that you have biological explanations by the simplest explanation, which is the way a physicist would think about it. We have to recognize the complexity and the redundancy that's round that. Now, I want to finish, I said, with a slightly technicolor few sentences. Because what we're talking about here is complexity in information management. And I think there is a possibility that this complexity will lead to counterintuitive explanations. You can't make obvious sense about it. It's not intuitive to quite work out what's happening. Now, most biologists, including myself, live in what I call a common sense world. You know, we have almost a sort of Newtonian type of way of thinking. I imagine this room as a cell, and there's a molecule over here, and it bounces to a molecule there. It's all Newtonian. But what I'm beginning to wonder is whether complexity will take us into a much stranger world, where that metaphor, that analogy in the way we think, will no longer be entirely appropriate. And in this sense, it may be like the changes that occur in physics, where in physics, the very big and the very small become increasingly bizarre to a common sense mind. And I'm wondering whether in biology that may happen as well. Think about physics again before 1900. It's mostly common sense. 1905, you have Einstein. Relativity starts getting tricky. If you read a popular book on relativity, you read it, it makes some sense, you close it, and then slowly it drifts away. Because it isn't quite in our common sense world. You know, it's difficult imagining going at the speed of light and aging at a different speed from somebody else sitting on Earth. And it makes sense as you read it, but it isn't embedded in the way that we think. Now, if you have a problem with Einstein, move on to the 1920s and quantum mechanics, and you start living in an Alice in Wonderland world where nothing makes any sense whatsoever, where cats are alive and dead at the same time, and you can only make sense of it with mathematics and reasoning that is simply beyond the normal common sense. I can say this with great confidence because my daughter is a high-energy physicist. It's what she does. She works at CERN. And when I realized she doesn't understand it either, that I felt heartened by this. They have these little sort of workshops all the time to sort of remind themselves of the complexity and how you deal with it. And it's really, really difficult, because it is difficult. I hope I'm not insulting anybody here. But it makes sense in terms of the equations, and it gives exquisite descriptions of how things work, but it isn't in a common sense world. The question is, will the complexity of our biology take us into a similar place? And I think that might well be the case. So, four ideas: the cell, the gene, evolution by natural selection, life as chemistry. The fifth may be information and systems. Thank you very much.
Questions. I think we've got time for about two. So if you raise your hand.
I do like questions, but please shout, because I'm a bit deaf. Okay? So wait for the microphone.
Where was it? There's one there.
In your list of great ideas, you didn't start how it all started, that great idea.
You mean how life started?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that's simple. Yeah.
That's because I don't think we have a good idea to explain it. It's actually really difficult. I mean, I'm only going to state the problem. I mean, everybody must know it here. This planet formed 4.2 billion years ago. It may be cooled to something like a sensible temperature 3.9, 3.8 billion years ago. The first life is 3.5 billion years ago. Within 200 or 300 million years, we have life. I do not know how that is possible, the complexity of it. Remember that, and it was single-celled life from 3.5 billion years down to about 800 million years. So it took nearly another 3 billion years, actually, to make multicellular life, which for me is a trivial problem. I could easily understand that, but I could not understand how the first occurs. Of course, Fred Hoyle said it just came on a comet from somewhere else, which is possible, I suppose, but I'm afraid does push the idea back elsewhere. I have no idea how life formed. Mea culpa, white flag.
Hi, good evening, Sir Paul. Thank you very much for a really interesting presentation. Gary Hayes. 3D printing. So we're told that we're going to be using those organs, much like we saw on The Fifth Element, where you can put in a microwave something, it comes out a toasted chicken. What is your expectations in that direction? What are they?
Well, 3D printing, I think, in a sense, is relatively trivial in this. I know it's talked like this. It allows you to make very precise shapes, which is important. What is really difficult is actually getting the cells that you now have to put onto those shapes to actually make an organ or a tissue and then an organ that will actually do something. So the shape is useful, but we could solve that tomorrow. But getting the right cells there, changing into the right types of cells, linked to other cells that will actually produce a functioning organ, a pancreas or a heart, whatever, is the really tricky part. Now, that is being worked on. Of course, stem cells are central for that. We've understood some of the concepts for decades, but only in recent years have we understood some of the chemicals or treatments that you have to make to turn one cell type into another cell type. And that is going to lead to progress. I'm sure it will lead to progress to repair nerve and muscle damage. Not immediately, but I'm sure it will do that. And I am making a BBC 4 TV program about it, so you'll see that a bit later. Yes, go on. Quick, microphone, quick. Sorry, I...
Marvelous lecture, thank you so much. In thinking about your pushing the envelope out to quantum mechanics and astrophysics, etc., to me, the functioning of the brain and some 10 to the 19th things happening per second, and both that and the ability to store memories for long periods of time seem like there's some of those boundaries of speed and phenomenal cellular, molecular, chemical reactions.
Absolutely right. I mean, I didn't talk about brains. I mean, it would be another idea to put there. It is because this is another ferociously difficult subject, in actual fact, like the origin of life. It was ferociously difficult. The brain is the most complicated object we know. It is extraordinary what it can do. We are only just beginning to scratch the surface. At the Crick, I think we should focus on really simple brains like flies and worms, because I just don't think we've got a chance with useful brains like our own at this moment. And I think that we have to get the principles sorted as to how we can do that. It's a really challenging problem. If I was 22, I might do it. But I'm not, so I'm staying with yeast. I work with yeast, single-celled organisms, simple problem. That's about all I can cope with at the moment. Sorry,
okay,
I interrupted.
Yeah. I'd now like to invite Professor Maggie Dalman of Imperial College to propose a vote of thanks.
So, Paul, my task is actually a very simple one, so thank you for such a brilliant lecture. You know, the use of historical perspective really does remind us of the incredible conceptual leaps that were made by the early scientists that completely underpin our understanding and indeed are the basis of the great ideas in biology. But you also bring us right up to date with your provocative thinking about our current emergent ideas of biological complexity and organization, and indeed the enormous challenges that these bring to our way of thinking. And I've never understood some of the concepts in physics. I'm relieved to know that others don't either. And the thought for me as a biologist of having to adopt that sort of thinking is incredibly challenging, and we should leave it to the 22-year-olds. I particularly enjoyed your story, Mendel's story, actually, showing us that nothing really changes in the competitive nature of science, and indeed how great ideas often can be ignored. And I fear that many of my great ideas have been and will be ignored. Maybe one day somebody will listen to me. But Paul, it's been an enormous privilege, actually, for me to get to know you during the development of the Crick Institute and observe your really very single-minded brilliance in pursuing a goal, whether in doing your own science, and less just to make sure that people are aware, Paul is still a very active bench scientist, runs a group, always has done, always will, I'm absolutely sure. Or in whether it's in leading great organisations in which you have done many. And we absolutely have no doubt that it is this that will make the Francis Crick Institute the great success that we expect it will be. So, Paul, thank you once again for everything you do for science in the UK and for your brilliant lecture this evening. Thank you.